different behaviors in this place. That's because they're not, they work full time, I guess.
And a chain around him, it's like, in the 60s.
I'm old with my glasses, I hope.
to encourage you to use that tool. I think it's a...
They wanted to stick around. Want the manager to stick around with the kids.
Well, the coaches write the rules. Just always remember that. Okay? That's why they're all messed up. It's because the coaches write the rules. So, but the intent of, because a lot of guys, I mean, I don't know, you know, hardly anybody actually uses the restriction. You use the restriction, restrict the coach before you eject them. I've never restricted the coach to the dugout. I personally think it's counterproductive a little bit. You know, go put him in timeout.
But you don't have to put in a special report.
No, but the reports aren't that hard to write. Like, the guys that say, oh, I hate doing paperwork are just lazy. Like, it takes 2 minutes, you know, to write up a report. You know, I don't have a whole lot. I had one last year for the first time in, like, 6 years. So it happens. If it happens, you need to deal with it. You just, now, you know, the process should always been, you know, ignore, acknowledge, warn, then eject. Now that warning has a written portion to it. I don't think you don't need to do anything extra. You know, you don't have to take an extra fifth step, written, you know, warning, then written warning, and then eject. It's just formalizing the process. A lot of coaches probably, you know, I'm guessing, they complained that they didn't get warned before they got ejected. And they say, you know, then the umpire writes in the report that he warned him and he never got an official warning. You know, now it's, you know, saying you've been warned, you know, I'm still leery about the bench, you know, having to restrict to the bench, but if that's what you have to do, you have to do it. And then after that, even said in the rule video, a minor infraction, you know, the next, you know, beats balls and strikes, you warn him about balls and strikes, and he makes a comment about balls and strikes, you go, just like with your kids, if you tell them, you do that one more time, and you're grounded, and then they do it again, and you don't ground them, what do you do? You
know? I really need it next time.
You're encouraging, yeah, not only, you know, you're really encouraging the coach to yell at you, because you know, he knows, he's learned, you taught him that there's no consequences for it. You know, if it means, you know, if it makes you feel like you're being hard-ass, so be it. But, you know, just when you're warning, you know, be clear with the other aspects of it, and you won't have to get to that eject portion. If you're clear with the ignoring part, obviously you just ignore it. Ignore the comment, you know, don't, you know, just let it go. Then you acknowledge it and say, you know, coach, I heard you. You know, we're not, you know, it's about balls and strikes. Coach, I hear you. We're not going to discuss balls and strikes today. Okay? That's kind of the unofficial warning. The next one, he does it again. Hey, coach, now you've been warned. Okay? We're not going to talk balls and strikes. Now you're restricted to the dugout. Okay? And if he, from the dugout, starts yipping at you, then you throw him out. Okay? Now, if you ring somebody up, and the coach comes barreling out and starts yelling with balls and strikes, and you just skip right, you blast through his warning, and you throw him out. There's still that provision in there that you can do that. So don't think I have to, as you, you know, he comes out and say, oh, that's your warning, and then throw him out. Like, there's provisions for that. So
just the written part, Ellen, to be done at the same time of the official warning?
Yes, just write it right then. Like, make a point of it. Say, coach, this is your official warning. You've been restricted to the dugout. Take out your line card. Write down, you know, any outs, you know, based whatever, you know, time of day, whatever you want to write down. But just so you can put it in your, you know, if you have an ejection, you can put it in your.
I thought you're supposed to give it to him.
Well, you verbally give it to him, okay. And then you don't have to hand him a card. I was joking when they said he had to give him a card. Even though I think that might work, you know, it'd be kind of funny. Maybe calm him down a little bit. Here's your official warning.
Like, so your
no, yeah. You don't have to hold up a red card. Which would also be funny, and I think might diffuse the situation a little bit, but might also backfire on you too. So probably shouldn't do that, but again, it's always the thing is, it's like, I'm going to do this in my last game, but you know, when you don't have to hurry. Go umpire somewhere where you're not going to see these guys again and just do all the goofy stuff you always wanted to do. If it feels good when you say it, it's probably not worth saying. Any other question? Anybody, you know, guys are just popping in, we're talking. I actually went through and watched the rules video, the exciting 27 minutes of my life as they went through it. Anybody else have any questions on the rules video as you went through, or the points of emphasis, or anything we can kind of discuss? I mean, I have some videos set up, but we don't have to kind of go off topic if we really want to a little bit. No? Nothing really major this year. It's just, you know, some editorial things. The warning, the official warning on the on the objection process, for lack of a better term, is new. But other than that, most everything's the same, unless I'm missing, you know, I can't think of anything else too exciting out of there.
Helmets, if there's any kind of tape or anything like it. It's...
Yeah, that wasn't on there this year. That was from last year. But yeah, like, it's not supposed to be tape on the helmets, but, you know, don't be anal about it either. You know, just the undercut. You know, if there's crack, the helmet's compromised. Yes, get rid of it. But be smart about it too, because there's, you know, freshman programs and stuff that, you know, that don't have the funds or barely have enough kids to play, and now you're gonna name down one helmet and they got borrowed from another team. Like, just be smart with it. You know, don't compromise the safety of you. If they have just a little bit of tape and you can't tell if there's a crack, let it go. It's not going to be the end of the world. As you move up, I mean, as you get varsity level, yeah, you know, get a different helmet. Every kid's got their own, just about, and do it there. But, you know, be smart about how you enforce some of the rules, too. And everything's not black and white in the rule book. There's a lot of gray area, and that separates the umpire ability. I really feel if you umpire with the rule book, not by the rule book. And you all know you got good guys that just, you know, by the book, do it, and there's no gray area. Those guys just it's a sticking point for them in their career paths. I've seen it number of times. You can be John Muller, you know, is probably one of the better rules guys. Okay, he knows every rule inside and out, the intent of every rule, the history of every single rule. But he doesn't do it by book of law. Okay, you read situations and you work with the rule book. It's when you want to do everything exactly right, exactly how the book says, is when you get in trouble. Okay? And how many people here drove right at the speed limit or under, never went a single mile an hour over? Okay? How many people drove by a policeman going 56, you know, and 55 on the way here? Did you get pulled over? No, but if you umpire straight by the rules, you should follow that cop and tell them to write you a ticket. Right? It's the same thing. It's life is not black and white. In baseball, you know, baseball is not black and white either. So make just, you know the rules, know the intent, you know everything you can about it, but don't let it hamper your ability to, you know, have common sense on the baseball field either. Yes, sir.
In a way. Away from umpiring for about 9 years.
Okay.
I've got my kids through high school, so I'm back at it. Now, I'm going to throw a bombshell in your lap, and you can throw it right back at me. But when I got out of umpiring the last time, I just went through the rule book last night and read the definition of what is the strike zone. And I'd like to get a feel from the gentlemen who are here, what the hell is happening with the strike zone, if anything, in the last 8 years, because ankle strikes were the norm, and strikes, well, especially, I saw it way too much. I don't want to say norm, but I saw way too much. A low strike, and where the strike zone is up here. So, has there been a point of emphasis in the last two?
No.
So what have you seen?
So, you know, I don't know, how long did you umpire up until the point when you stopped?
I was 8 years.
8 years working like varsity baseball type?
I worked freshman, sophomores, and I did a couple of them.
Okay. Well, for the level, you know, that level, you kind of get what you can get. It depends on the pitching, depends on the catching, right. Depends on the ability of the players. Varsity baseball, I don't think there's much, really anything's changed since then. You know, the way I look at it is you can't get pitches that they can tell from the dugout aren't strikes. Okay, up and down. But that's the hardest part. Low the knee pitch is the hardest pitch to call. That still had, you know, the ability to do things haven't changed over the years.
Okay.
you can get in and out a little bit. You can go.
Well, I understand the black and metal.
Yeah, in and out.
I get that.
It's really about presentation by the catcher. That hasn't really changed.
Right.
And it's about, you know, top of the zone. I mean, it's, you know, nipples to knees. It's really what you can look at. I would say they don't like the high strike as much as they like the low strike. They'd rather have you call this pitch than this pitch.
Right. Well, that's where I was frustrated. I sensed that I was a high school catcher, I was a player, and I sensed that the whole box had dropped. And
yeah.
I just wondered, I gathered a little bit from reacquainting myself with the rule book put it out there.
Tell you the truth, the rule book's not a good place to go look for the strikes of philosophy.
I get that too.
Because nobody calls it by the book. Yeah. If they do, they don't last very long.
And the consistency, I get the, as long as you're consistent.
Yeah.
Blah, blah, blah.
I'd say the biggest thing is, especially, if you get Barton Barcelona, even some good sophomore baseball, it's how the catcher catches the ball. If it's a borderline pit, if it's right down the middle, it doesn't matter what he does.
That's
right. But the knee, hollow the knee, pitch, and he beats it in the ground, the ball. Everybody up there knows, everybody saw that, it's a ball.
Right.
If he sticks it and it's just even a little bit lower than that one, you can get it because it looks good.
Right.
They can see that from the dugout. They see that they don't look for when the catcher catches it. They look at the whole thing. If the catcher gets it oof, against his chest, I'll say to the catcher, let me see that.
Well, that pattern is still.
It's all the same. Strike zone. I really don't think strike zone philosophy has changed since you left. I mean, this would be my 16th year, and I don't think it's really changed much since I started. The more strikes you call, the better.
Well, that I always understood.
It's better to be a big zone than a small zone.
Yeah.
Some of our guys, like Jim Ellison and Bert Person, the guys that moved up, were state finals all the way through, they got a wide strike zone. They got a big strike zone. Okay? Might not be the best. They might not be the best rules guys, but they can call a good play and they get, that personality to make it through that. So be big, bigger than smaller, but don't go crazy either, because that can get you in trouble too.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
Anybody else? I don't want to dominate. Other guys, what your kind of your philosophy with the zone is. I think it's kind of what, from my understanding of it, as you go. But.
It's huge.
Yeah.
The strike zone is huge.
Yeah. I mean, underclass baseball.
That's what I was interested in promoting a little. Because it frustrated me because there wasn't that element of consistency among umpires, but the umpires were consistent that I had a chance to work with them and see, and at least that was a blessing. So I was wondering if there had been a point of emphasis in the most recent years to.
I don't remember.
I
don't remember ever seeing a point of emphasis on the strikes. Really, tell you the truth, coming from the Fed. I think there was an NCAA a couple years ago, there was something about it. Obviously, I was just fighting Matt Moore's call everything that doesn't get the ground.
They did want you to grab some more of the higher strikes.
Yeah, and they said something about the width of the
chalk and chalk.
Yeah, chalk and chalk.
Yeah.
Ball and ball.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I think they actually said something against that a little bit, if I remember right.
Rodemont Gross misses outside the zone.
Yeah.
It's, as you said, it's how much, where the catcher sets up, how he receives it, where the presentation.
Yeah. And I've had coaches actually tell me, it's like, I can't see in and out, so they're not going to complain about in and out. Their big batters can complain about it, everything, but you're okay there, but they can see probably better than you on the low pitch. So make sure you get it. Good.
And the other thing I would say, encourage you to set the strike zone early, so right away you go out and get your strikes early, so you're setting the precedent to get the mat swinging on it, try to go do that later. So right in the first inning, get those low strikes, and get whatever strikes you can so they're swinging the bat and it's cold in the spring and get the game
ready. Yeah. And if you start off tight, it happens to everybody. You start off and you're tight. Your zone's tighter than you think than it normally is. you can inch it back out too. You know, don't be afraid to, man, I called that pitch a ball, you know, a ball in the first inning, but I probably could have got a strike. Now I'm going to call a ball all day. Just work your way back. You can always, you know, inch your way back out.
Thank you.
Yep. Yep. I mean, balls and strikes is the hardest part of the game. And it's the most important part. It's how you, you know, it really, if you can't figure out calling pitches, you're not going to be umpiring very well. You know, nobody's a career base guy. Doesn't matter, you know, some guys probably want to, but you know, nobody's a career base guy.
Yeah, like Danny Salzman always says, you know, you're going to get yelled at either way. You might as well get yelled at for calling the strike.
Just, yeah. Mm-hmm. You'll get yelled at for less time if you call more strikes. If you're tight, they're going to yell at you. You're going to have longer time to get yelled at.
Okay? Well, I'm convinced that the player, and I don't have any data to support, but I'm convinced the players prefer it that way, too. Because they'd rather see action rather than standing up.
Yeah. They'd rather see a big zone when they're pitching and a small zone when they're batting. So some announcements. I see some newer faces too. If you have not signed, if you're planning to come to the Belvedere Clinic this weekend, tomorrow will be the last day to sign up. We're at like 82 people, I think, right now. We can bump that number up a little bit more. Really, it's free for members. So if you're a member, you can come to free. Wheaton College is in 3 weeks, I believe, or 2.5 weeks, or whatever.
2 weeks from Sunday.
I can't focus past Sunday, but March 5th. Belvedere is kind of a condensed version of the Wheaton Clinic, so if you've been to the Wheaton Clinic before, we have three full tracks there. Belvedere's 3, Wheaton's 4. So you know, kind of one in one building, not moving around a little bit, but. Same speaker, a lot of speakers will be there doing the same type of presentations too. We try to overlap a little bit for guys that can't make both. Honigs will be there. I think today's the deadline to pre-order for Belvedere. Got some good deals actually on their shoe. That's a pair of shoes. I need a pair of base shoes, so I was looking at their flyer. They got some good deals on that stuff. Anything, come for half the day if you want. You know, come out and see something. You know, you can always pick something up. I mean, I go around and kind of watch everybody as it goes through, and you can always pick something up. And you can never have too much training for to be in an umpire. So if you can make it out, registration links are on the Facebook page. You've been in about 15 emails that I sent out to you guys, so you should be able to find them there. I just say deadlines. The test is available now, so make sure you print that out, start working on it. We're going to do a test review session, I believe, on the last night. I have to look and just make sure if it meets the deadline or not, to double-check that. But it'll be towards the end of these sessions. We'll go over the test one night. And then the rules video is out. We're talking about that a little bit. But that's out. Make sure you watch that. It's part of the whole process. The Part 2 test, if you're going for promotion this year, will be coming out. It'll show up on your profile once you complete the Part 1. But I think there is a four or five day window we're talking about the other night in the webinar when you can take the test. So make sure you get that done before the deadline. I think it's March 22nd is the last day to take the test. Don't go. They put you on probation if you haven't done it. But it's an easy test. If you're unsure about your answers, everything, just show up that night and we'll go over the test and you know, do it. Remember, that night's not an answer giving session. It's a test study session, so make sure you have your test done and rules, references, everything, go through it. When you do go through the test, make sure you go every single rule, you know, every single question, and find a rule of reference for it. Even if it's the simplest question in the world and you 100% know the answer, find a rules reference for it. It'll help you practice going through the rule book, help you find, you know, and maybe you'll find something that you missed or you have less chance of making a little tiny mistake. I have the most pressure. I have to get 100% because I'm going to give all you guys, you know, we're going to go over the test and you're going to see my answer. So I make sure, you know, I have rules reference for every little thing. But it helps you. It helps you be able to find stuff in the rule book. I mean, it's hard. I mean, after a game, you've got to look something up. It'll help you practice going through it. I recommend they do have digital versions of the rule book. I know IHSA only sends them out every other year, so we don't have a newest version this year. But they have a Kindle version, rule book and case book. And That's what I think in iBooks version as well. But you can search it on your computer. It makes it so much easier to find stuff. Search by keyword. Go ahead, Nick.
They do have a printout for 2016. I had to buy them this year.
Oh yeah, you can buy them. Yes, the IHSA doesn't send them out.
Right. And then one night, you thinking about doing that test review?
Yeah, it's gonna be one of our last sessions. So.
You have a tentative date on that?
I want to say 17th of March. Okay. I'm not 100%. It's on our website. What day? It's the last session. The last Thursday session. Let's see here.
When you sign up for the clinics, you're gonna need that promo code.
Yes. Promo code's FEV2016. So you enter that in, you'll get free. Unless you want to donate $40.
Otherwise, you don't get registered. Otherwise, you pay or you're promoting.
Yep. We tried that. Last year, we just let people say they're going to pay at the clinic, and then we had a bunch of people just not show up. So we're trying to avoid them. We have too much food. And, you know, there's a million and a half moving parts to run in the clinic. So if ever interested, give it a shout. But the agenda... I sent out to people that were registered for the clinic. They should have the agenda, or there's a link to it on their Facebook page. I'm going to send it out in a blast email. I'm going to send an email probably tomorrow morning saying tomorrow is the last day to register, and then I'll have a link to the agenda so you can get it. It is fluid still. It's a Google Sheet, so I can still update it. If you're going to print it out and bring it, print it out Sunday morning or late Saturday night just to make sure things might move around a little bit just to make sure the flow of the clinic goes. But we do have and for guys that came to the Belvedere Clinic last year, there's no wrestling tournament this year, so we have the whole facility to ourselves. We have the gym this year for the mechanics instead of in the cafeteria. Honigs will have the cafeteria to themselves, and so you can go and mingle in there if you want. We're using the same rooms, but with the one room, we're going to pull the wall down so we have a bigger venue for there. So it should be, we got through with some of the bugs from last year, you know, into this year. So, any other questions on that? I think we're pretty close. I might just turn it over here. I'm going to turn it over to Bill. Why don't you introduce yourself a little bit and give a little
background? I'll do that here. Yeah.
All
right. I'll tell you what, I'm going to put this out here.
Okay. All right, good evening, guys. My name is Bill Mushrush, and there's a few of you in the room that I've had the occasion to meet before, but most of you I don't know. Most of you that I've never worked a game with. Been a member of FEB for I think 4 or 5 years. I'm a DuPage Kane County guy. I do a lot of DuPage Valley, Upstate, West Suburban, down that way. So when Alan asked me to come and do this tonight, I was a little nervous because the last time I tried to give a presentation to a group of umpires was about a year ago down at Naperville North. I'm a part of the AOA group that meets down there one night a week, just like this format leading up to the season. And I got up to give my presentation, and my presentation would not run at all. And I was dead in the water. So I was winging it, literally. So then when I saw last week that this was going to be videotaped and put on the website and all that, the anxiety level was just like, wow, I better have my act together. But I appreciate the opportunity to come and do this. Alan asked me to be a part of a committee that met way back in, I guess it was November, yeah, to work on a curriculum for these sessions and the clinics. And as a part of going to that meeting, we all got a topic to work on, and I got conflict resolution. So, you know, like usual, I kind of let it go until about a week ago when I really started getting serious about, well, what am I going to say? What am I going to do? And so we're going to talk a little bit about conflict resolution, but we're not going to talk about it as a, you know, an isolated topic that has nothing to do with umpiring. You know, there's going to be a lot of what Alan already talked about tonight, woven through this presentation, because it's impossible to talk about conflict resolution without getting into other aspects of umpiring, because it all is connected and feeds together. So, let's see if I can get this thing to move here. So, when I started getting ready to do this, I thought, well, I need to read some of my favorite reference material or books that make me think a lot about umpiring. Okay, so one of them is Verbal Judo, and this has been around a long, long time. Many of you have probably been in another clinic or training session. Anybody besides Bill with a law enforcement background? Okay, this is really big in law enforcement. It's also gone over into all kinds of other career fields and so forth. Was it 2 years ago or 3 years ago at the clinic in Wheaton, they brought a guru in from Texas. Was it 4 years ago? Okay. And he did a fabulous job putting on a presentation about verbal judo. So tonight is not me trying to do what professionals do about verbal judo, but it was something that I picked up and read through again to help me get my mind wrapped around this topic for tonight. Another book that I didn't bring the actual book, but if you've ever heard about or read the book, They Called Me God, Doug Harvey book, kind of a whole different perspective about umpiring, very much from a professional point of view, very much from a pre-social media era when baseball, you know, to some of us might have seemed a little more pure and every game wasn't on television and it was a whole different era. But that really, I still always go back to that book and read a lot of things. Now, you know, by the title, it's a little, to some people, it's a little like, oh, my God. You know, he has a book written about himself, and he puts right on the cover, They Called Me God. But, you know, there's a lot about conflict resolution woven into his book. So I recommend it to you. Even if you're not interested in reading about conflict resolution, it's a great read and got a lot of history in it. So, and as a young teenager just starting to umpire, Doug Harvey was my idol. He was the one I wanted to be like. He was the one that was just cool and in command and had that presence. And nobody ever messed with him too far. And you could tell the players and the coaches and everybody respected him immensely. So he was always the guy that I aspired to be someday, and just a legend in the career of umpiring professionally. So, okay, I've kind of danced around it. Then what is this presentation really going to be about? Okay, I'd like to frame it as a framework, a conceptual framework, a philosophy, an approach, and I'm going to try to present to you is based on some actual research. I mean, verbal judo, there's been a ton of research on this, especially in the law enforcement field. And then a lot about experience and recaps many things you already know. As I look around the room, first of all, almost all of you are north of 35 years old, and probably almost all of you have been umpiring for more than 10 years. So I'm not here to tell you a bunch of things that's like, oh, my God, I never heard that or I never knew that. I'm just, part of this preseason ramp-up of these weekly sessions is just kind of get everybody wrapped back around baseball and get ourselves all thinking in the same direction. And that's my goal, not like I've got any silver bullets to hand out tonight. What the presentation is not, I already said I'm not going to try to give you a verbal judo course in 45 minutes. That's just not possible, and I don't think I have the expertise to do it, but it is a good foundation. I've gone to so many clinics and so many presentations in both basketball and baseball where a clinician or a presenter gets up, and it's just a string of war stories, and I promise you I'm not going to do that, okay? We've all got experiences and colorful stories to tell, and that's maybe great when we're having a beer, but I don't think that's the way I want to spend the time tonight. I'm also not going to give you a list of here's the six magic things to say, or here's the six magic things that if a coach says them to you, then this automatically happens. I'm not here to give you like a toolkit like that that you can just walk out and say, okay, I got it. Now I just got to do this. You've all been umpiring a while. You know that the challenge of this whole thing is adapting to the context of what's going on, what the situation is, what's the game, you know, what brought it about, what's led up to that. So that all plays a lot into it. And it's definitely not, this presentation is not a replacement for actually doing it. You know, umpiring is like playing golf, flying a plane, whatever it is. You want to be good at it, you got to do it, and you got to do it a lot. And and when Alan mentioned a minute ago about strike zone and you'll never progress or you'll never even hang in there if you don't learn to call balls and strikes, I always tell younger umpires trying to move up, you should be, when you get to the point where you're getting to work two-man games, you should be volunteering to do the plate every chance you get. Because that's where you're going to make your mark. That's where you're going to get better. That's where you're going to be noticed by coaches. That's when you're going to get a positive report to an assigner about the job you did. It's almost always going to be about your plate job. They pretty rarely make a phone call to Jeff Collis or another assigner to talk about what a great job you did on the bases. Just doesn't happen very often, okay? All right. Okay, so Alan wanted me to tell you a little bit about my background. Here's how I would boil it down. I've been umpiring quite a while. But not just umpiring feeds into what I do. 16 years as a high school teacher dealing with teenagers. Well, you learn how to do some verbal judo. Otherwise, things escalate like crazy really quickly. Or dealing with parents, same thing. And 18 years as a high school administrator, even more than about dealing with parents and other outside influences that don't have a lot to do with what the kids are doing. I also spent 30 years in the Army Reserve. So I thought all three of those things that I've done in my life kind of all fed and helped each other. And I firmly believe that umpiring helped me a ton in my academic career and in my military career, because there's a lot of parallels. You know, there's a lot of things in common. I've had the privilege of working with a lot of great partners and many mentors, and you know, there's probably a group of a dozen umpires that I've worked with for 30 years. And I love showing up at a game working with one of those guys, because I know exactly what to expect. You know exactly what your day's going to be like. Even if the baseball turns out to be a little disappointing in the quality of the play, you're still going to have a good day and you're still going to have an enjoyable experience. And I had some really great mentors along the way that gave me some great opportunities and continue to give me the kind of feedback and accountability that we all need. And I've seen lots and lots of high school coaches. I've also done some college ball, but most of my career I've been focused on high school. And please don't take the fact that I'm up here talking tonight that means I got it all nailed. And I, you know, this is strictly a work in progress. I forget some of the tenets of this book every week or two out on the field. Somebody pushes your button, and you let them push your button, and then next thing you know, things are going in a totally different direction. And when you get in the car and you're driving home that night, you go, why did I let that happen? You know. So it's a work in progress. It really is. Okay. Before we get into the actual meat of conflict resolution, I think it's important to have in your mind, you know, why are you umpiring? What's your goal? Nobody's doing it for the money, right? I mean, that's not the primary motivation. If you started out as a young kid doing park district games and they paid you cash on the field, yeah, it was all about money back then, no doubt about it. But as you progress and you move up and your life gets more complicated and you've got work responsibilities and things going on in your own family and all these other things going on, and your body maybe gets a little less enduring to some of the things that happens during umpiring, and you know, next thing you know, it's pretty easy to say to yourself, you know, why am I doing this? Well, it's obviously not just for the money. So I'll admit, there's a bias in this slide. You'll pick up on it, okay? The first thing is, are you trying to be the show? Do you think everybody came to watch you? You know, I hope you would, that would not be the case, but we all know there's some guys out there like that. Okay. I went to a college basketball game last week, and Ted Valentine was there standing at midcourt before the game, and I said to myself, oh boy, you know, Television Teddy's here, and he thinks we all came to see him. And, you know, he's been doing that for a long time, and he's a good enough official, he gets away with it, but we all know there's people like that, that they think the reason everybody came to watch the game is to watch them umpire. And that's, I don't know, that's kind of a risky a way of looking at it. There's some umpires out there that everything's completely black and white, everything's absolutely by the book, and every coach is a rat. Okay? Again, if we were professional umpires, maybe we'd be appropriate to be a little bit more on that spectrum. But my point of view is, we're not professional umpires. We're umpires who want to be as professional as we can, and we want to do a professional job, but it's not our only job. It's not our career. It's not our bread and butter profession. So, you know, the philosophy of every coach is a rat, I don't think that fits amateur baseball. I don't think that fits the games that most of us are working on a day-in, day-out basis. We all know there's umpires out there that their approach is, I'm going to avoid conflict at all costs, and I'm going to take my chances on how that makes me vacillate from one position to another, or one philosophy or another, or how I respond to situations. They just want to avoid conflict at all costs. Then we also know there's plenty of umpires out there that they really want the camaraderie and the friendship with the coaches. You know, they want to go have a beer with a coach after the game. They want to talk to that coach like, you know, they're buddies. And I've seen many good umpires get into that mode, and I say to myself, boy, oh boy, that's kind of a slippery slope you're getting down on there. Yeah, that could blow up in your face down the road, but they're out there. And then there's also the guy that when you show up to work with him, you just know you're going to get into some trouble. There's a few people out there that are just a magnet for stuff to happen. And sometimes it's because they just can't leave a situation alone. Sometimes it's because they maybe forget about some of this kind of stuff and they just say whatever pops out of their mind, and they just look for trouble. And they feed off that drama. There's umpires out there like that. I would hope that maybe these last three bullets ought to be more the common goals that most of us share. Like, number one, you want to be respected, not just by the coaches, but also the players and your fellow umpires. You know, the coaches are in somewhat of an employer role. I mean, the reason we're there is we're working for them to do that game for them. And that comes with a certain inherent accountability. And you want to earn their respect because you're doing a good job. The players, you know, that the better players are going to pay attention to when an umpire is doing a good job and may give you some feedback and some informal ways that they appreciate the job you're doing and they like what you're doing. And, of course, you can usually read your partner about, can you tell they enjoy being on the field with you? Are they calling you up the day before the game and saying, hey, I'm really looking forward to it? Or are you just kind of cringing, thinking, oh boy, I got to work with that guy tomorrow, and what's going to go wrong? Hopefully you understand, or you always keep in your heart the fact that you want to be fair and you want to be unbiased. That's just a given that we have to always strive to keep in mind. And you probably want to progress. You want to move up. You want to work better games. You want to work bigger games. You want to get those three-man assignments. You want to work those tournament games. You want to be the guy that gets to play it in a big game, and you want to have fun. So those are some of the goals that I would think we have to keep in mind, and that directly connects to the topic about conflict resolution. I don't know who to attribute this quote to. But I know I read it somewhere, and I've always kind of tucked it in the back of my mind. But the reason we do get paid what we get paid is because it's not easy. The reason that 14-year-old gets paid what they get paid to go out and do it for the 8-year-olds that are playing is because it's not easy, because none of the parents want to do it, because all the parents are going to yell at them. And that's why they get paid as well as they do. That's why we get paid as well as we do. I mean, why does a D1 umpire going out to work a 3-game series get what they get? Because the stakes are high, the pressure's high, and the accountability is way up there. So, you know, we really start earning our pay when our authority is questioned or challenged, and our expertise is questioned. Okay. This is another quote that I don't know who to attribute it to, but one of the secrets to success as an umpire is knowing when to respond to what you hear and when to pretend you didn't hear it. I'll just diverge just here for a second. I started doing basketball last year. Okay, so I'm 58 years old. I've been doing baseball for over 40 years, and I get up one morning and I tell my wife, you know, I need a new challenge. She's like, no, you can't go learn to fly a plane. We can't afford that, and I don't want you getting killed. And I'm like, no, I want to referee basketball. I think that's a great idea, you know. And so I reached out to some umpire friends that are also basketball refs, and I, you know, kind of got the advice and who to call, and who to, you know. So here I am doing basketball. This haunts me all the time in basketball, because my 40-plus years of training in baseball is, I screen all that out. You know, there's a little more distance between the dugout and the bleachers and the field and home plate. And I just screen all that noise out. And I don't pay attention to most of what comes out of the dugout. I don't even hear it. If I do, I just pretend I don't hear it. So now I'm doing basketball, and I've got a coach asking for a timeout at a time where you don't really anticipate that they want a timeout, and I'm not paying any attention. I'm not even hearing it. And it's got me in trouble a couple times, but this is how you survive in baseball, in my opinion. This is a really important thing, to not react to everything you hear, and a lot of what you hear, you act like you didn't even hear it. Okay. All right. Okay. So when you look into the book on verbal judo, or another book I read recently was the new one that Referee Magazine came out on. What's it called? Ejections and Warnings. They wrote a book about ejections and warnings. Okay, it's a pretty good little book. And they talk about how conflict is inevitable, but by virtue of the fact that it's a competitive game, there's conflict built in right there from the get-go. Okay, it's not. Will there be conflict today? There's always conflict, right? It's so expected. A key part of our job is handling that conflict professionally and successfully, and keeping things unbiased and fair in the process. And as you move up, conflict management and your overall communication skills are even more important than your rules knowledge or your mechanics. Now, that's just me saying that, but I firmly believe that those are the things that make you stand out, and those are the things that will get you in trouble if you don't take care of them as you move up, is your conflict management and your communication skills. Because we all know that rules knowledge will only take you so far. And most of the coaches and most of the players, the finer points of the rules, they'd have to get the book out and really dig into it to be confident, right? So we get paid to know the rules, and that's a fundamental competency we have to have. But it's not something that's going to make or break you as an umpire in most situations. It's more about your communication skills and how you can handle conflict. And as I said before, while we want to be professional, we're not professional umpires. And I think we need to keep that in mind. I think every coach deserves our respect from the get-go. I don't think a coach should have to earn our respect. Now, I will go on to say, though, that if I give a coach a respect to start with, they can lose it. They can work to lose that respect,
But I think we have a responsibility to give them respect from the get-go. But the reverse of that is, we know we have to earn ours with them. It's not a two-way street, it really isn't. We are held to a different standard, a higher standard, and to get their respect, it takes a lot longer and a lot more consistent experience with us before that's going to happen. Okay, I already got a little ahead of myself there. So if we communicate succinctly, respectfully, clearly, directly, we make sure that the sarcasm and the tone, and that can be really hard to not have sarcasm and tone, especially if it's somebody you've been working their games for 20 years, and all of a sudden they're coming off half-cocked about something really silly, and they're just yapping about it, and you'd love to give them a little sarcasm or a little tone back. Not the best thing to do. If you let yourself do it, now you're climbing out on that limb that's getting weaker and weaker as you climb out, and that could come back to haunt you. But that's one of the beauties of being able to do this, is you get to decide, and you get to live that from day to day. And every game, every situation is unique. It's not going to be the same every day. So you get to work on that on a day-to-day basis. If you're gracious, calm, you come across as being prepared, and you're direct and yet professional, that's going to go a long way. But at the end of the day, there's a certain point in every umpire's experience where you got to have courage, too. And I'll maybe hit that a little more directly a little bit later. But it does require courage to do the right thing sometimes and to shut somebody down when they're way off, you know, going off on a tangent that has nothing to do with what we ought to be worrying about, or they're just flat out trying to get an advantage that's not fair. We have to have the courage to address that. So a little bit more about verbal judo directly. George Thompson was an English professor who became a police officer. He became a street cop. And, you know, he had all this English and communication academic training in his background, but when he first became a cop, he didn't pay attention to any of that. He thought, I got a badge, I've got a weapon on my hip, I can exert my influence, and I can make anything happen I need to have happen. And he figured out pretty quickly what anybody in a position of authority like that, whether you're a police officer or you're a dean in a high school or whatever your role is, where you think you've got this authority that you can just whip out anytime you need it, he started to realize that was not getting the successful results that he needed. So, hence the birth of verbal judo, and he really spent a lot of time developing this, and then eventually went all over the country for probably 20 years training police officers and other groups all in this skill. And I think he died in 2011, but you know, his five universal truths, and I'll put the next slide up so you can read them a little bit easier, that he kind of boils it all down to is that all people want to be treated with dignity and respect. They want to be asked to do something rather than to be told. You know, would you please step out of your car instead of get out of your car right now, okay? They want to be told why they're being asked to do something. And you can see some parallels that with umpiring baseball, where a coach or a player wants to know the why. Okay? Even though we could say, I know the rules, and you don't. It's not my job to explain the rules to you. It's not my job to teach the rules to you. This is the way it is. We're moving on. It's human nature that we all want to know the why. Okay? And everybody will normally respond better when they have options to pick from rather than threats. So the option might be, you know, coach, we can wrap this up and you can go back in the dugout, or I can give you your warning and now you're going to be restricted to the dugout or something like that, okay? And still, you're given choices. And almost everybody appreciates and desires to have a second chance, whatever the context is. We all want a second chance. So those are the things that verbal judo are based on. And then he talks about his acronym is LEAPS, which is listen to the problem first, and don't just hear it, but actually listen. Then empathize to show your support. Now, when you say empathy, what? Somebody tell me. Somebody give me a definition of what you think of when you think of the word empathy.
Put yourself in someone else's shoes.
Put yourself in someone else's shoes. Okay. Anybody else got another twist on empathy?
Feelings for what that person's going through or what's going on with them.
Okay. So you try to put yourself, understand their feelings and what they're going through. You try to put yourself in their shoes. You try to turn the equation around and look at it from the other direction. But yeah, and so it sounds maybe kind of sappy when I say when that coach comes out and is beginning to have this animated discussion with you that you're supposed to show empathy towards them. But it really does help diffuse those kind of situations if early on the person who's agitated and upset and raising the intensity of the conflict understands that you're listening, but then it comes across that you're actually empathizing to some degree to understand where they're coming from and what it is that's got them upset or agitated. Then you ask questions to clarify. You paraphrase and you restate what they just told you. Now, this sounds kind of mechanical and it sounds almost artificial, but what we're talking about is, so coach, you're telling me that you think that that runner missed second base and you think that I wasn't looking, and you're telling me you want me to go to my home plate partner to ask him if he saw a second base tag? Is that what I hear you saying? Okay, now that may sound hokey, but just going through that can diffuse so many situations because they get confirmation that you heard what their beef is or what their concern is, and that you actually restated it back and paraphrased it. It goes a long way to showing empathy, and that you're not just exerting your influence and your authority. You're actually having some working together towards a resolution. So paraphrasing for correctness and restating is really important. And then you summarize. And then when it's time to wrap it up, you give them options. and you, those options may not all be all that palatable to them, but you're still giving them options. And then get the game going again. So in a baseball application, there really is a lot of a parallel between where this originally came from and law enforcement. My wife's always telling me I interrupt too much. I interrupt her too much, and it is a bad habit I have sometimes. I get my brain going, and I want to dive in and get my thought out on the table before the other person's finished theirs. But in verbal judo, they actually recommend that interrupting can be a very effective tool, especially after you've let that coach go for a while. You let them get some of their concern out, and you let them, vent a little bit. Now when you interrupt, you got to be careful how you do it. You don't want to do it in a real judgmental way, but if George Thompson, his favorite one was, whoa. Now let me make sure I understand what you're saying. Or excuse me, did I hear you say, I don't think too many of us are going to say, pardon me, coach, did you just question my integrity? But using some phrase like that to interrupt in a non-threatening way can be very powerful, and it gives you a chance to empathize, and it also gives you a chance to move the process along, because at the end of the day, you want to get the game going again, right? So you empathize, you make sure you understand what they're talking about, and then you paraphrase it back, and then you, as always, you remain in control and move towards the resolution. The minute you let the coach push your button or the player push your button and take it to a whole other level and you give up control, now conflict resolution is pretty much out the window. It's not going to end well. Okay? So, and there's times where you don't have any choice. They push it so far that you have to respond somewhat in kind. So I think I've already kind of given the parallels. Yes?
Go back to that last screen.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to go too fast.
Thank you.
Yeah. So, you know, I hope you see some parallel here between the verbal judo and what we're doing as umpires. So, this is kind of an abrupt transition, but I think it's important when we start talking about conflict resolution to put it in the bigger context, or in my opinion, the priorities as an umpire. And this came up in the beginning of the meeting tonight, but this is just my opinion. This isn't out of a book or anything. But calling balls and strikes is the number one thing that establishes you as a quality umpire and will move you up and get you better games and get you to the point where you walk out on the field and you actually enjoy working a game and you feel satisfaction that you did a really good job. If you don't become a good ball and strike umpire, the rest of this is probably not ever really going to happen because you're not going to last very long. It's just a requirement. Now, I know there's other clinicians or presenters that will argue with me about this, but to me, rules, knowledge, and mechanics are down the list. What's next after balls and strikes is game management and professionalism, is the umbrella that I like to put it under, okay? Because that's what the coaches remember next after how well you call up balls and strikes. The next thing they think about you when they hear your name, when they look on their schedule and they say, oh, he's coming to do my game tomorrow and we're playing a first place team, yeah, that guy runs a good ball game. We're going to have a good day. It's the game management and professionalism. It starts with when you walk out onto the field for the pregame lineup card meeting. It starts then, and it goes all the way through how you conduct the game, how professional are you, and a huge part of that is the conflict resolution, if you have to do it, and your overall communication. Those are the key parts, in my mind, of game management that will set you apart from other umpires, and you'll be the one that the coach goes out of his way to make a call to Jeff Collis or another assigner and say, hey, so-and-so really nailed it today, did a really good job, I want to see him back. You know, we got that crosstown game coming up, and you're going to put three umpires on that? I'd like to see him be one of those three. That has a lot better chance of happening when your game management and professionalism is really something that sets you apart in a positive way. Rules knowledge doesn't come up that often. I always tell people, and you know this, I'm sure you've told other people, that, you know, they'll say to you, oh, you're an umpire? You do high school baseball? That's got to be really hard. I mean, the rules are so complicated. Do you ever say to them, well, actually, the better baseball you work, the less the rules are a problem. All the crazy stuff happens with the little kids and the freshmen and the lower level games, right? The higher the baseball, the better the baseball is, the less the rules pop up and you have the crazy situations. Now, when they do, you got to know what you're doing. You can't fake it, and you got to have a good foundation. But what I'm saying is your rules knowledge does not get tested day in, day out, inning in, inning out, like your game management and your professionalism can and will, okay? And then your mechanics, yes, they're important, but we're probably the only ones who really understand whether we got the mechanics right or not in most situations. There's a lot of coaches that think they understand the mechanics. They'll bring it up when they think it helps, you know, that works to their advantage, but we all know that they pretty much don't know the mechanics. And so that's why I put it kind of at the lowest priority. So anybody got any response to feedback? You think I'm all wet? Yes?
I just have a question about frost-soft level because that's what I do. Yeah. That's what I enjoy. I like working by myself. I don't get lineup cards. These coaches aren't coming out and giving me lineup cards. You know, where do I go with that?
Well,
plus they can substitute. Their rules are a little different.
I'm gonna talk about in a couple slides here about context of the situation, but I think that's totally appropriate. I mean, many times those coaches are very inexperienced. Sometimes they got thrown that job to get the teaching job, and they didn't really want to be a baseball coach, but they were told, you're the freshman baseball coach if you're going to be a teacher here. Many of them are by themselves. They don't have an assistant. Some of them have kids that have been playing a lot of organized baseball, and some of them have kids that haven't had those opportunities, and it's all over the place. So
I think you have to adjust, just like you talked about that you do, to fit the level of the game and what and what's going on.
Most of them are volunteers. I don't think they're teachers.
Yeah, and that happens. I mean, even at the varsity level, it can matter whether it's a non-conference game the first week of the season and everybody's freezing their tail off, you know, versus that first place conference championship game at the end of the year right before the regionals start. I mean, there's a continuum there, and that context absolutely matters on how you're going to handle certain things. There's some things that have to be consistent and the same in every game, but when you're doing those lower level games, I think most people would accept the fact that you're not worried about lineup cards. You're more worried about keeping the game moving, getting the kids swinging the bat, and making it somewhat of a positive experience, and most that you can influence that, because everybody knows baseball is an unbelievably boring experience if it drags and it's walk after walk and it's ground ball through their legs and fly ball getting dropped, and it just never it's hard to derive a lot of positive out of those kind of games. And so your role is a lot more of keeping that game moving and giving those kids a chance to have a pretty positive experience, especially when they're not all kids that have had a ton of other baseball experience before they got there.
It's the same with the uniform roles.
Yeah, exactly. When I referee basketball, they've told us a million times, do not nitpick about, you know, the kid's got the undershirt on that says Nike Combat across the back of the collar at the freshman level. Now, the IHSA just put something out a couple days ago saying, varsity referees, you haven't been enforcing this, and darn it, you're going to enforce it now because we're tournament time and we're not going to have all this hullabaloo about uniforms again. They're not allowed to have that showing. They're not allowed to have the Nike swoosh showing in front. There's not any logo allowed to be shown on their undershirts. Same kind of thing in
coaches
baseball.
Are supposed to be in uniform.
Yeah, well, that doesn't happen that often at those levels either. Yeah, especially early in the year. Everybody's worried about staying warm more than they are about being in uniform, right? So, any other comments or feedback about this priority thing that I threw up here? I wasn't trying to start something here. It's not designed to be controversial, but there's also room for a lot of other opinions here. I'm sorry?
I was just saying, you email that to my HR and ops leader at work.
Okay. Yeah, that could apply to some other situations, yeah. Yeah, we all have those things that would be the meat and potatoes, the balls and strikes in other situations. So this is the context that I was just alluding to. It's a key part of the overall game. Starts at the home plate meeting. And, you know, you need to figure out a way to command respect. And for every personality and every individual, there's different ways to do that. But if it is a varsity game and a coach is not giving you a lineup card or he gives you one that's not done properly, those are opportunities to start to command a little bit of respect. You do it in a tactful way, but you hold them to the standard and you say, Coach, you know, I need all the subs listed on here. They're not on here. So would you take it back and put those all on there and bring it back out to me in a minute? And they'll look at you like, well, what's that got to do with anything? That's part of setting the standard, commanding a little respect that you're holding them to the standard. You're not being a jerk about it, but you're addressing it. And there's lots of other things like that you can do that help build that, help you build that command of the game and the field. So, and another thing that it sounds so blatantly obvious, but you know, coaches care who wins, and umpires do not. But we can't also go out on the field acting like we could care less about who wins. You know, there's a difference. We got to act like we care that it's fair, and it's a well officiated game, and it's competitive, even though we could care less about who wins. Okay. But it sounds so fundamental, but we always have to keep in the back of our mind they care who wins and we don't, okay? And that really has a lot to do with how we approach conflict. All right, so I started looking for video clips. And guess what? When you go looking for video clips on YouTube or MLB.com and you're looking for conflict resolution between coaches and umpires, whether it's college, professional, whatever, what's all on there?
All conflicts.
The ones where conflict resolution and verbal judo just kind of went right out the window. Right? So I thought, well, if I'm going to show a video clip, I'm going to show a good one. So this is my favorite. And this is Bill Howler and Earl Weaver. And I don't mean to offend anybody.
Once more. I get my money, I'm already out.
And you'll have your chance tomorrow. Not it as quick as
what
you
can.
You ain't no good.
No, you aren't either.
You ain't no good.
You're no fucking good either.
Yeah, right. So never have our games.
I hope you have your work here.
Yeah, what are you doing here now?
Well, why don't you go to the league office and ask me?
Yeah, I will.
Oh, good.
Don't think I won't.
Good.
So that's probably the most extreme example that I could come up with. And, you know, we could analyze it and pick it apart, but I guess my main reason for showing it, other than to break up the monotony of me talking a little bit and give us all something to chuckle about, is that this is a professional context. And also in that context is, Howler's been umpiring in that American League for probably 30 years at that point, and Earl's one of the deans of the managers in the American League at that point, and they've been having conflict and headbutting for decades. And so, you know, verbal judo and empathy and all that, you know, it's beyond the point of no return for them. As you know, like it could be in a couple going to marriage counselors, you know, that it's just not, it doesn't matter who the counselor is, it doesn't matter what the technique is to try to help. You know, that the couple's never going to work it out. So that's kind of why I showed it as a kind of an extreme example. And also that those are pros. And, yeah, the language, we would never tolerate that for a half a second. But those of you that have maybe gotten a chance to work some higher-level college games or any level college games, there's a different standard of language and what they can get away with saying. It's more about jobs. It's more about wins and losses translates to whether or not that coach has a job the next year. And that's just a reality. Most of the games we're doing, whether it's at the high school level or it's other leagues in the summer, nobody's job is swinging in the balance because of whether or not they win or lose that game. And so the standard of what is appropriate is much more restrictive because that plays into it. Okay, so my point is context has everything to do with it. Now, when we do have a high school game, you know that when it's a big game, everybody's amped up more. The players are amped up more. The coaches are amped up more. We're usually got the juices flowing a little bit more while we're getting ready at the car and we're getting ready to walk out there and we have our pregame with our partner. We're probably going to be a lot more deliberate with that pregame when we know it's a big game than when it's a non-conference, first week of March and all we're worried about is do I have enough layers of clothes on, right? Your reputation and experience matters too. If you walk out on the field and that coach has seen you do two or three of their games every year for the last 10 or 15 years, that plays hugely into the context of how any conflict is going to be handled because you know them very well, they know you very well. We also walk out on the field saying what happened in the past, but we also know that that does color where the threshold's at when things do start going south, how quickly they're going to get over that threshold, okay? It's just human nature that we can't completely put the past out of our judgment, out of our mind. What's the head coach's stature? Is this a second-year guy at a struggling program and, he's getting his brains beat out, most games, and he's frustrated because he's only got one pitcher, and it's just not a great situation? Or is this, a guy who's got three state championships, he's been at the same school for 25 years, he's got an unbelievable feeder program, and he's always got plenty of arms, and, he's got a program that's rocking and rolling and does really well every year in the state tournament, always competes for the conference championship. Those things absolutely matter when you find yourself in that argument, discussion, conflict with the coach. And then what type of call is it? What are we talking about? Are they coming out to talk about mechanics? Because if he's trying to talk about mechanics, you're going to cut that off pretty quickly because that's really not their purview to talk to us about mechanics. But if you're talking about the application of a rule and it maybe is a little fuzzy and you maybe are kind of winging it, or maybe you and your partner weren't exactly sure what to do and you came up with the best you thought you could do, that changes the context. That changes how far you let things go because you know that the rules are maybe not real black and white on what you're supposed to do in that situation. Was it a judgment call? And that is something that you have every right and authority to point out early on in that conflict resolution. We're talking about a judgment call here. We're not gonna go on and on about my judgment call. Obviously, if it's balls and strikes, it probably means that conversation is going to be even shorter. But any kind of judgment is much more, we can show a little bit of empathy, but you're not going to get the same length of time and the same amount of empathy, and you're not going to restate much of anything when you're talking about a judgment call. And then, of course, about mechanics, I already said, they don't really know that much about our mechanics. But it's a little bit different than arguing about a judgment or a rules thing. All right, so I'm going to kind of make this a little more interactive at this point. I'm going to throw a couple scenarios at you. Okay? And I'm going to ask for a volunteer to be the umpire. And I'm going to play the role of the coach. Okay? And Mr. Vincent, I'm going to put you in the skillet right off the bat for the first one, okay? Will you help me out?
Sure.
Okay.
You know, and I was always there for you too at all these meetings.
Well, you know.
Are you going to do this? All right.
I thought if I'm going to put somebody really on the spot, I'm going to do somebody I know can handle it. So, all right, so here's scenario one, number one. Okay? I'm Coach Phil Slipple. I'm a Hall of Fame Illinois baseball coach. I've had multiple state championships. I'm at a Providence Suburban High School. I've had many players play in D1, a few make it to the pros. My team's loaded every year with talent. Okay? You're working the Crosstown Classic with our sister school. It's a big rivalry game. Jeff put three men on the game, and it's going to decide the conference championship. And there's a huge crowd present. Maybe we're even playing it at a college field just to amp it up some more.
I've done that game.
Yeah. Okay? And every umpire has stories about working games for Coach Slipple, but this is your first year working an all-varsity schedule. And you've only worked two non-conference games for him in the past. Okay? So, you and him haven't had that much experience with each other. All right, so here's the scenario. You're part of a three-man crew. You're working with two state final veterans, and you have the plate for the first three-man. This is your first big three-man marquee game. And Coach Slipple is very talkative with your partners at the pregame meeting, but he doesn't hardly give you the time of day. And you're the plate umpire, okay? But he's flapping backs and telling stories and going on and on with your partners. And in the second inning, with a runner stealing second, Coach Slipple thinks his catcher was interfered with throwing to second by the batter who reached across the plate to swing an outside pitch. Okay? And Coach Slipple comes out on the field and is not happy. All right? So we got the situation. All right. Yo, Bill, you got to understand, this is a big game, and I got to have your best effort here. Now, I don't think you were paying attention when that catcher tried to make that throw. That batter interfered with him, and you didn't do anything. Now, come on, Bill. This is a big game. This is Naperville, by God. We expect the best for our kids here in Naperville. You got to understand. Now, what are you going to do? You got to go to your partner for help. Bill, you got to go to your partner for help. I bet they saw the interference.
Okay, Coach, I understand your issue. I understand what you're saying. That's my call all the way. My partners can't help me on that call. I do not have interference. That throw went through. I don't have interference. If I do have interference, then I'm going to call her right away, and then we're going to move forward from there.
What do you mean you can't go to your partner for help?
I'm not going to.
Those two guys have been working my games for 25 years. They know what they're doing. I've only seen you a couple times. You know, what do you mean you can't go for help? Why not?
I'm glad you've worked with those guys for a long time, but that has no bearing on the situation. That's my call all the way. I'm the only one who can make that call. I do not have interference on that play, so we're going to move forward right now, and that's all I've got for you. So let's go. Let's play baseball.
Well, you'll never work this game again.
All right, here we go.
So, go ahead, Bill.
Yeah, one of the things I think I would not want to do is, like, personally, let him have that last word. It makes no difference to me. I think when he walks away, I'm walking. And if I engage and want to get that last word in, then I'm just starting something that's already ended. So,
right.
And thank you.
Well, thank you, Bill. Now, so I picked on the guy who's got professional verbal judo training right off the bat, but also one hell of an umpire. So, that's not that far-fetched of a situation, guys, right? These coaches, you know, when they're in the heat of the battle in a big game, rational thought is not always going to be first and foremost in what they come out and say. He was more worried about how inexperienced he perceived the plate umpire to be and how much he thought he was buddy-buddy with the two guys on the bases that have been working his games for 20 years than he was about the actual call. Okay, that was just you could conclude that was just an opportunity for the coach to come out and try to look to plant some seeds and get an advantage and start to maybe intimidate you in a somewhat disguised way. Okay, or it could have been that he really thought it was interference and it maybe his catcher told him he got interfered with and he's going to believe his catcher more than he's going to believe you.
That could be the case too, okay? But that's not that far-fetched of a scenario, is it? Okay. Bill handled it great. He listened. He let me go a while. He didn't let me go forever. He restated some of what I said, but then he also was pretty clear about, that's my call. There's nothing about it I need any help with. I totally saw it. I didn't get screened out by anything or anybody. No, I'm not going for help. Because the minute he pushes you into going for help on a situation where it's really not necessary or advisable, now they're starting to manipulate you, and it's not going to get any better from there. And that'll carry over to future games. Okay? If you let him push you in to going for help on something that there's absolutely no reason to go for help on, that kind of manipulation could carry over to future games. Okay? All right, so if I got a volunteer, I only got one more. If I got a volunteer to play umpire on the next one, somebody? I'm not going to go Earl Weaver, I promise. Okay, come on up. All right, so here's our scenario. Your coach, Ken Pasquini. You're a Hall of Fame coach with multiple state championships, and you're at a pretty prominent suburban school, and you're considered by all umpires to be the consummate gentleman. And you're really a model coach. You really are. The way you treat your kids, the way you develop your players, the talent you get out, how well you get good play out of the talent of your kids, you're just really respected. And you always play well at the end of the season, no matter how bad the beginning of the season's gone. When tournament time comes, you're in good shape. You're also working a cross-town rivalry game with your sister school, and it's for the conference championship. Okay, somehow we've got it together to where you're playing for the conference championship. Every umpire you know loves working games for Coach Pasquini, and he rarely gets into conflict with umpires. You've worked with his games for many years without any serious conflicts. And during the pregame meeting, he's very gracious towards you. So your partner working the plate is a younger, relatively new varsity umpire working more and more high visibility games. He's an up-and-comer. And he appears to be very excited and nervous during your pregame and coming out onto the field. In the fourth inning, with a close play at the plate, your partner calls Coach Pasquini's runner out on a very close play at the plate. But what your partner doesn't see is that the catcher dropped the ball during the tag. But you did. You're on the bases, and you saw the ball drop. Okay? Coach Pasquini comes out onto the field, very fired up, especially for him, and comes straight to you near second base, asking you to give your partner help. Okay? All right. I'm sorry, what's your name?
Robbie.
Robbie?
Yep.
Robbie! Come on now! Robbie! Robbie, you know me. I don't ever come out. Robbie, he dropped the ball. Yeah. And your partner didn't see it. You got to help him. Robbie, come on now. This is a big game, Robbie. And drop the ball.
Okay, Coach, I understand how you're feeling. You know, you saw the ball drop. You know, it's his call. If you want to ask him, he can ask me.
Did you see the ball drop?
It's his call. If you ask my partner.
You didn't answer my question. Did you see the ball drop?
I cannot give my partner help without him asking me for help. You have to go talk to him.
Yeah, you guys all stick together. I know that. I've seen that. But come on. Now, I'm telling you, I'm asking you reasonably. This is a big game. This is a big play. Half the people in the park saw the ball drop. Your partner got screened out. I'm not saying, you know, that, you know, he wasn't trying to make a good call, but the ball was on the ground.
Okay, well, Coach, I'm sorry, but you have to go to my partner. If he wants to ask for help, he can, but otherwise this conversation is over.
Well, but I've known you forever, and he's new. He's nervous. I can tell he's never going to admit that he dropped he completed the call. You Coach, come on, you're Coach, the vet. You're Coach, the vet out here.
This conversation is over. You have to go back to your dugout or talk to my partner.
Okay. Okay, so, good job, Robbie. So, is that a far-fetched scenario?
No.
Okay. What about when he kept saying, did you see him drop the ball?
Didn't answer his question.
Right. And I think you handled that textbook. Okay? You're not going to throw your partner under the bus. You're not going to put yourself into a predicament by giving any kind of inclination that there's something to be talked about. It really is needs to be your partner who wants the help. Now, the only thing I might say that would be a good tactic to use early on is to right from the beginning say, Coach,
you know,
that's his call. No. You need to be talking to him. Okay, Coach, I respect that you're fired up and you're not happy, but you need to talk to him. And if he wants, and you did say if he wants my help, my partner has to ask for it. But you might have tried to even a little more quickly direct it to the home plate umpire right off the bat because he's a nice guy and he doesn't come off too fired up and he doesn't get too in your face and he doesn't get too insinuating about you doing anything wrong. So that leads to letting it go some, right? So you're showing empathy and you're trying to restate, but at the end of the day, he's got to be directed back to the home plate umpire, right? And you got to be so careful not to give any nonverbal confirmation that the ball was on the ground. Now, has anybody got an idea what might have happened or what should have happened long before Coach Pasquini got out there? Bill?
So it would be my opinion that if you're, you know, one of the things, too, I think you got a pregame situations that are going to happen like that, like when you're going to go, when your partner's coming to you for help, so you'll recognize that sign that something's going on. So if it was, I was on the bases and I saw the ball drop to the ground and it's going to happen, your partner's straight lined or in a position where he's not going to see that legitimately, I'm immediately doing what we talked about in pregame, which for us would generally be, I'm starting to walk definitively towards my partner. My partner is going to see that coach come up. My partner is going to look to me, and he's going to see me walking towards him. And so we're going to probably put a halt on that coach right away before he even comes up and have a conflict. Because now we're coming together. And in high school, you can't do it, but in college, you put the coach in the dugout or in the box to have a conversation. But I would say encourage that private conversation. I'm then going to go to my partner and say, hey, did you have a good look on that tag all the way through? Because I saw that ball come to the ground. Are you certain of your call? You want to stay with your call? My partner's probably going to say, but look around and we got that ball come to the ground. If he doesn't say something like, oh, I saw that, but I thought he held it long enough, now he's owning that ball. And then next thing I'm probably going to do, so if he's going to change that call, then we're also talking about how we're going to handle that change. So that rendering umpire's going to make a proper call, and we're also talking about how we're going to handle how the other coach is not going to come up. So,
right.
But I would definitely try to get the call right.
Right. I mean, that pregame thing is so important, and you know what happens. You get caught in traffic, you get there at the last minute, you've worked a zillion games with the guy, and you think, well, we don't have to go over that much. Wrong, okay? Because of that exact kind of situation. You know, some guys say, you know, I'm going to take my hat off. You know, that's probably a little too obvious, but there used to be a school of thought. A lot of guys would do that. They'd take their hat off if they were the base umpire and let the home plate umpire know, come and talk to me. But I agree with Bill. Just walking straight towards and heading it off before it becomes a big conflict, especially when you're the more veteran umpire on the crew and you know that the home plate umpire is, you know, in a really tough situation. You want to help them. You don't want to let them hang completely out there on their own. You also don't want it to look like you're, superseding or trumping them, but by coming directly to them and having that pregame where your partner knows, if you see me coming at you, we need to talk about something, you keep the coach away and you have that conversation and you get it sorted out. The end result's going to be a lot better than what the scenario I gave, where you let the guy come out and get all over you, and then you just go, oh, I can't talk to you about it, I can't talk to you about it. Yeah, that's true, but it would have been a lot better if that hadn't even happened. Yes.
I just wonder if that's more of a college mechanic or high school. Usually we're told, you know, I got something, you better come over here, I got something, as opposed to showing up the umpire by walking to him, which everyone's looking at, which means that he's got something and he's going to help, you know, the plate umpire or something. Or what happened.
Again, I think the context is really important and how severe, you know, this is one where it was really obvious that the ball was dropped. This isn't a gray matter thing. You know the ball was on the ground. And so I think that gives you a little bit more of a license to initiate sending a signal in whatever way you pregame to your partner that we need to talk. So those scenarios I threw in there just to kind of try to make some of this a little more illustrative of what I've been talking about. Context, who the coach is, what kind of game is it, what's your experience level, what's your credibility with the coach, what's your partner's credibility with the coach, all of that plays into it. Now, that may sound like, oh man, that's too complicated. That's not why I started umpiring. Really, that's when you get up to a better level of baseball, that's what it's all about. Those are the nuances that separate you from just being an okay umpire to being one that people want on your big games, and Jeff wants to be able to give you the best assignments, and your partners really are going to look forward to seeing you show up at a game to work with. Okay?
Has there ever been a situation where the late umpire, after he makes the call, realizes the ball dropped and your partner never really saw the play, where you communicate and change the call? Where the late umpire actually knows he made a bid?
I mean, my perspective is, that base umpire's got to be 100% sure.
Yeah, okay.
I mean, I'm not gonna be afraid to change it if he is 100% sure. I mean, I would hope that we're all pretty much got that common philosophy that we want to get it right. Now, believe me, what we see on TV every night in Major League Baseball drives me crazy because they get together on everything, and everything's video reviewed, and I mean, it's so distorted now. And that affects what people expect out of us.
What, 40% of plays at first are overturned?
Yeah. I mean, people coming out to watch a high school or college, a junior college game around here or whatever, they know we don't have replay. But yet they still think we ought to get together and talk about it. So it's a reality of, you know, it trickles down from big league baseball. It affects people's expectations. And I'm telling you, in my experience, it's more and more every year that coaches expect us to talk to each other and consult with each other after a call than it ever used to be. And they're less accepting of that, you know, I don't have to talk to him about it. I don't have to go to him for help. I saw it. That's the way it is. And you got to be careful about which calls you use that on and which ones it seems appropriate to go ahead and have your partner confirm you got it right. Or have your partner say, I didn't have anything, so the call stands. You know, like in the NFL, the difference between them saying the call stands or the call is confirmed. I mean, there's a little bit of that when you're going to your partner. They have something that absolutely contradicts what you had, or are they not sure? You know, that's kind of... It doesn't always feel good when that's happening, but we're supposed to, but above all, want to get it right.
So,
yes?
Just quick comments on that. Just make sure you are 100% right. There was a college game a year or two ago where they had a no-call on potential pitchers. But the glove was probably about 20 feet away. The runners are on first base, I want to say. The home plate umpire, you know, got screwed together. He said he only heard one sound. They figured that because the rope went 20 feet away, that they would fall into experiencing defense. And they were 99% sure. And if you can see the replay, then you can just go over the ball. So,
right, you do have to be sure. Yeah, it's a slippery slope. All right, I don't want to go too long here, guys. I just want to wrap this up. A phrase that a mentor of mine told me, you know, a long, long time ago is, what you permit is what you promote. So what you tolerate, what you allow to have happen, is a standard you're kind of indirectly setting, right? So if you let that assistant coach bark at you, interpret you constantly, or be out of their dugout or out of their coaching box, and you know, in high school baseball now, we've got some beautiful defined restrictions now on assistant coaches, and they've had them in college for even longer, but you know, they're not allowed to leave that coach's box. They're not allowed to come out of the dugout, and they got nothing to say. That's gotten me in trouble in basketball now, because the minute an assistant coach starts to say anything, I'm just like, you got nothing to say. You need to sit down. You need to be quiet. And they go, you know, it's the same in basketball, but I'm just a little more attuned to it from baseball. That I'm not listening to assistant coaches. We're not having any conversations, right? You know, if the coach is chirping about balls and strikes, you got to decide how much of that are you going to pretend you didn't hear, and how much of that are you going to nip and end. And again, it has a lot to do with what are they chirping about, how's the game going, what's the context. You know, one of my pet peeves, and I know there's a lot of people who disagree with me, but it's been a point of emphasis about 3 years in a row that we're not going to let coaches sit on buckets out in front of the dugout. We're not going to let them be out and play all the time. And yet, day after day after day, I work with guys that don't want to do anything about it. And so those of us that enforce it kind of come across as being, you know, a little too, you know, hardcore about it. But when you let them sit out in front of the dugout on a bucket, you're setting a standard. You're saying, you know what, I'm going to pick and choose which rules we're going to apply today. And, you know, I'm going to let you be out there because I don't want to have a confrontation with you about it. And if one that really drives me crazy is, and it's not easy to address and deal with, but you need to do it in a professional, discreet way, is when a coach is not expecting sportsmanship out of their players. When they know things are happening and trash talk is going on and kids are doing things that are just not a part of amateur baseball. Maybe okay in the big leagues, it's not okay in amateur baseball, and they look the other way or they let it happen. You have to have the courage to address it. And that could get you into a conflict resolution. There's no doubt about it. So, and some others, if the coach is coaching you more than his team, you know, that gets old in a hurry. If the coach is doing things to embarrass you or your partner. And this is one, as a veteran umpire, that I have to be careful about. But there's been some situations in the last few years where I'm working with a younger partner who's maybe just starting to get varsity games, and the coach is riding them, and the umpire's not doing anything about it. And it gets to a point where I have gone in between innings, or I've gone at times where, you know, it's a little more discreet, and I've said, you got to knock it off on my partner, you know. And I think of one coach that I told you I wasn't going to tell war stories, but this is a guy I have tremendous respect for, and I've worked his games forever. And he's just all over my partner. And I was on the plate, and he's out on the bases, and the play happened two batters ago, and he's still chirping about it. And finally, I just let him have it. I said, you know, you need to knock it off. And he's like, what, you're just protecting your partner? And I said, you're damn right I am. I said, you want to see him back out here next year? I said, you want to still always have old guys like me working your games, or you want to have some young guys actually stay with this and keep doing it? You got to knock it off. You know, the average umpire that signs gets licensed with the IHSA doesn't, 60% don't come back for year number two. You know, I told him that. He actually sent me an email that night apologizing and understood where I was coming from after he thought about it. Now, that's not going to happen very often, but it was a classy thing to do eventually. So, of course, attacks your integrity, starts to use profanity in a way that just is like over the top. Boom, you got it. You got to nip it. You got to address it. And I think I've ejected 5 guys in the last 25 years. Okay, so I'm not somebody that, you know, is looking for opportunities to run guys. But if they cross that line, you got to do it. If you don't, you're setting a new standard. And the problem is that standard now carries over to the next day, for the next crew that's working that guy's games. He thinks that's now the standard. Okay. When things do get bad, you still got to command respect. You got to demand it. And as long as you're still communicating clearly and you're under control, you've got the upper hand. You decide when it starts and when it ends. You're in control. You're the one running the game. And they need to get that feeling right from the time they hand you the lineup card. It's your game. You're running it. Assume you're being video recorded. Right? In this day and age, everybody's got a phone. Somebody's going to send a video out of whatever happened. You know, and they might send it to Jeff. They might put it on Facebook. You need to remember that. It's going to happen. Okay, everybody's got a video camera in their pocket. And at the end of the day, can the way you handled the situation or the way you tried to resolve the conflict, can it be defended by your partner? Can it be defended by your assigner? When Jeff gets that phone call, is he going to have solid ground to stand on when that coach is letting him have it about what happened and he thinks you didn't handle it right? And most assigners are going to call your partner and get another perspective. Okay? So, you know, that just you need to have that in the back of your mind. At the end of the day, we're accountable. Give them choices. Now, all the choices don't have to be all that great, but give them choices. When it's time to resume play, summarize it, wrap it up. Give them the choices, set the limit, and if they refuse, then you got to do what you got to do. And, you know, the new thing with the written warning, you know, remember, that's not a requirement. You can still run somebody without giving them a written warning first. But, you know, the feeling of the Federation is that the restricting to the bench was not being used enough. Okay? And I think I've used it once, ever. And it was on an unbelievably respected coach who I never had any issue with. And when I said it to him, he's like, oh, okay. It means I get to stay, right? Yeah, you get to stay and you get to be quiet. Okay. Turned and walked away. But it's not like that's the perfect solution for every situation. You have to be very selective about when it's appropriate to give somebody that warning and restrict them to the bench. Remember, you're talking to the head coach only. Really, the more we all get together on that and the more we don't talk to assistant coaches, the better off we're all going to be. And stay in control. And, you know, professionalism is perceived as a one-way street. The people that are watching that game, whether they're parents, maybe they're school administrators, maybe they're the athletic director, maybe they're college scouts, whoever they are, they perceive that we as umpires are held to a standard and we're supposed to be professional and calm while the coach is not held to the same standard. The professionalism expectation is a one-way street, whether we like it or not. Now, the things that I've talked about tonight hopefully give you some ideas of how you can set the stage and keep things a little bit more as a two-way street the best you can. But at the end of the day, the perception of people observing that game, they don't really care how that coach conducted themselves for the most part. The threshold is much lower on for the coach than it is for us about what professionalism is. So it's just a reality. Okay? And I know you guys all know that, you've experienced it. So expect conflict, let the coach speak first, use the verbal judo, maintain those open lines of communication. And again, talk to that head coach only. You know, and be yourself. Don't be a robot. I don't recommend trying to be funny. Of course, I don't really have the capacity to be funny. But I don't recommend you trying to be funny, cute, or overly friendly. I really don't. You want to be respected. You don't really need another buddy. You need a coach that respects you, that you'll look forward to coming back and working another game for in the future. Okay? And that Jeff's going to get positive comments back about what a good job you did, how well he thinks Fox Valley Blues does with their training and their professionalism and the way they approach games. That's the payoff. Okay? It's okay to be tough. You can still be tough, but be fair and respectful. You know, and be a good partner and run that game with and command that respect and umpire with courage. Okay? That's all I got. Appreciate your ears.
All right, guys, so again, clinic this weekend. Sunday we're going to start at
clinic starts at 9. Honig's gonna be there, set up, ready to go by 8. We're gonna come early. Question, go ahead.
Registration only on Facebook, or isn't it on the...
No, there's a website. It's the link to the registration's on the Facebook page, but I'm pretty sure, I don't know.
Tiny URL?
Yeah, tinyurl.com/FEB Belvedere2016.
I think I already registered. I can't remember.
Okay. You would have got it. You would have got an email. So search your email. You got a confirmation email. Then you registered for it. Okay. Next week we're gonna have. It's gonna be the coaches session here. Next week, Dave Forrester from Elgin and Matt. What's Matt's last name again? Castorino from Larkin High School. Okay. We decided to do this. We did a coaches session at the Wheaton Clinic about 3 years ago, and I swore after that we would never do a coaches session again. Okay. I get to tell one of the most arrogant umpires in the history of IHSA to be quiet. So, and I told him to shut the hell up pretty much. Okay, because he was beating on a situation about buses showing up late to baseball games. Okay? That's not why those guys are here. They don't control that stuff. They don't schedule buses. Okay? So to just be respectful to these coaches. We're gonna try to pull some questions together, questions that, can help you. Okay? It's part to help you out, not to badger a coach. Okay? One of the coaches, LG coach Dave, he's the last high school coach I threw out of the game. So we have a little history. I actually joked with him about it last time I saw him. But he's kind of a fiery guy. So he'd be, but he's not going to be fiery in this setting. Okay? So don't, if you had grudges or, things that, that's not what it's for. It's more for maybe understanding why, balls, things like that, why balls and strikes are a question, different philosophies on things. Okay? Bill is going to be our MC for the coaches session next week, so go ahead if you want.
Yeah, so, Matt and Dave been coaching for quite a long time. I know them both personally. We do that crosstown series at Trout Park, and so Elgin and Larkin usually play under the lights. We've been doing it for like 12 or 13.